For the SBS studios in Aotearoa, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land I'm recording from. I pay my respects to the Cammeraygal people of the Gurungai Nation and their elders past and present. I also acknowledge the traditional owners from all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander lands you are listening from. Hi, I'm Suraj Kolarkar. I moved to Australia at the age of 11, and since then had a fascination with immigrant stories. On this podcast, I'm delighted to bring you these stories firsthand as I speak to immigrants about their journey in settling in Australia. Everything from hope, fear, alienation, and ultimately triumph. Last week, I was joined by Anne-Emily Perils as she went from a life of luxury in France to working with her hands in the Aussie outback. My guest today is Ali Bahnasawy from Egypt. He followed his passion to work in media, which led him to opportunities of living in America and Germany. But it was Australia that ultimately ticked all the right boxes and felt like home. He's also part of the SBS family, working as a TV presenter and senior journalist. My guest today is the wonderful Ali Bahnasawy. I'm getting that right?
Yes, that's spot on.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for coming on. I'd like to start with your childhood. So tell me, where were you born and how was it?
I was born in Egypt. I'm 40 years old. So that was 1981. My parents left the country after I was born, like a few months later, and we moved to Dubai.
Okay.
Back then, Dubai wasn't the fancy city it is now. There was a lot of desert. The tallest building was a 9-story building, and that's it. We had an interesting and fun childhood there. After that, I moved between a few other countries, and here I am in Australia.
Oh, there you go. Well, you skipped the whole part of where the show will exist.
Only 39 years.
So tell me, after you say, let's pick you up at when you graduated through high school. What was the field that you chose to study in, and where did you study that?
Oh, I wanted to study philosophy at that time and become like a novel writer, a novelist. My father opposed this idea and crushed it.
He didn't like it.
No. My father comes from a small village in Egypt. And for him, only two jobs matter, either doctors or engineers.
Ah.
And he thought that I can be a doctor, but I didn't tell him that I didn't study biology in high school. He didn't know that.
Yeah.
So it was a huge shock for him that that his son will not be a doctor or a pharmacist. And then I told him, I want to be a philosopher. I want to write novels later, etc. And he said, no. You're getting into engineering. And you're going to be either an electric engineer or a petroleum engineer. After some discussions, I convinced him that computer science is the way of the future. And I joined computer science and did 4 years of study.
Did you feel while you were studying that you wanted to pursue something else? Or how did it go down?
To be honest, I wasn't good at computer science. Mm. It requires a lot of patience, and I'm not that person.
So much patience.
Yeah, you can tell, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, when I started programming, and at that time, we had a very famous course. It was game programming, and it was using a programming language, C++. And at that time, C++, I think, it was a soul-crushing programming language.
The bane of the little programming that I've done, that is about as painful as it gets.
It is, and it's primitive. It doesn't give you feedback. It doesn't tell you what the error is exactly. I was asked to develop like a part of an actual PC game using it. Of course, this didn't happen. I managed only to create a man walking and bouncing while he was walking. That was my touch, the bouncing.
Yeah.
It doesn't look normal if you're just walking without bouncing.
Of course.
And the amount of errors I received and the difficulty I had solving these errors convinced me at the third year of computer science that I will never be a good computer science engineer. I will never. But nevertheless, I continued the year and I graduated with a computer science degree.
There you go. And then after that, you became the man walking and bouncing from country to country yourself.
Yes. At the beginning, I thought that I'm going to overcome how bad I am in computer science.
A comeback.
By working in companies that are not, they're not doing like fantastic games and projects, but I worked as a computer science for some time. And while doing that, I pursued a career in writing. That was the plan. That was the passion. I wanted to write novels and theater plays, etc. But I thought, let's be pragmatic. Find a good newspaper or a magazine, write for that, and get like some paycheck, and maybe someday you're going to write your novel. So that took me into the world of media, and I still work in the media for 16 years. I didn't leave computer science completely when I joined the media, because back then, and maybe until now, media doesn't pay well. Computer science does a little bit.
Oh, sure. So this transition into media, this happened while you were in Egypt?
Yes. Back then I was in Egypt. I was a teaching assistant at the university, teaching basic programming languages to management students and applied art students. That tells you something. If I was good, they would let me teach the computer science students, but they said, no. You're teaching management students who don't care about computer science. At that time, I started writing articles for free without being commissioned and sending it to magazines and newspapers saying, I'm that person. I want to write for you. This is a sample of my work. And slowly I start getting article published. And after a year or so, I got hired by two magazines, two sister magazines. One was Egypt Today and the other was Business Today magazine. Both of them were in English in Egypt, but at least it was a full-time job in a field that I like.
Fantastic. And was it media that took you out of Egypt? Was the first time you moved out of Egypt because of that line of work?
Yes, shockingly. Usually people who work in computer science will have more opportunities. Of course, you can see now Australia is one of the biggest destinations for people who work in the software field. But the first time I left Egypt and intended to stay in that country was to the United States. Back then, and still until now, the United Nations offer a fellowship to journalists. They bring four journalists from everywhere around the world and bring them to New York to work in the United Nations with the objective of letting journalists know how the United Nations is. It's a hugely complicated organization, and we don't know a lot about it. By bringing these journalists to New York and working, covering the Security Council and the General Assembly meetings, etc., they hope that you will go back to your country and write about the United Nations. But at that time, I fell in love with a woman and with a girl from New York and decided to stay there.
How many years were you in America, and where did you go next from there?
I stayed in America on and off, and it was basically because of the person I fell in love with at that time. I went back to Egypt permanently. That was the idea back then, a few months before the January Revolution,
right,
in 2011. And I was a journalist. I was trying to find my way back in the media field in Egypt. And I was very lucky to be there at the time where the protesters toppled Hosni Mubarak, the president that ruled Egypt for 30 years. I stayed there for some time, volunteered in politics, tried to educate, empower, all these big words, which was basically try to explain the constitution in simple terms in flyers and walking around the streets and giving it to people who might not be as involved as journalists in politics.
Was it dangerous?
At that time, after toppling Hosni Mubarak, no.
Okay.
I think it was one of the best times in Egypt's history.
Right.
Because there was really a balance of power between those who are ruling the country now for temporarily, and it was mainly the army and the security apparatus, and the political forces trying to have a democratic country at that time. So it was safe for a while, and From that, I managed to work in the elections, in 2012 elections. And after that, I became a TV presenter in Egypt.
Fantastic.
Hosting the morning show on one of the networks for a few years until I decided to move to Germany.
Okay. What prompted that move? You seem to have settled into this nice TV presenter role in media in Egypt. What inspired the move to Germany?
Things changed. We had too many terrorist attacks in Egypt. The army took on power in 2012. In 2013. Things changed in the media after that, and it became more difficult to do your job as an independent journalist at that time. We saw many independent journalists simply disappear.
Wow.
And we didn't know the story until years and years later. At that time, I was married, and me and my partner thought that we would like to move to a place where we can have a more normal life. And at that time, it was we had the opportunity to go to Germany, to south of Germany, and in a small city there called Heilbronn, close to Stuttgart. And we settled there for a few years.
How long did you spend in Germany, and what were you doing in Germany?
When we went in Germany, my partner had a job there, a permanent one first. And I had learned some German before going there, especially in high school and first year of college, but my German wasn't great. And I work in the media. And something that I learned about Germany when I went there is Germans are very proud of their language. They know English, but not a lot of English. Some of them are perfect in English, but they prefer to speak in their own language.
Right.
They don't like to make mistakes. Not like for me, as someone who is a non-English native speaker, you do mistakes all the time when you're speaking. For them, that's a big deal. So they try to avoid that by speaking German.
Right.
And when they speak German, you have to interact for them. And if your German isn't good, that will be difficult. So I had to study German intensive for a year, 9 hours every day.
9 hours a day for a year.
Yes.
That was the learning curve of moving to Germany.
Yes. It was shocking at the beginning.
Yeah, that is a full, that's more than a work day.
Absolutely. No, and that it's not over when you go home. You have to do homework and learn the new words that you learned. And they give you like homework that you need to listen to the news and try to understand it, listening to it from the TV, which is usually a faster form of speech than when you're talking to someone who understands that you're not German. I have to say, I liked the German culture. What was difficult and made me plan my route, my escape route out of Germany, was the social connections.
Right.
It was difficult to build social connections there over the three years that I spent. I wasn't in a big city. My partner didn't speak German. She tried to learn, but she had a full-time job, so I wouldn't blame her for not being able to catch as much German as I had, as I could. And after some time, we said, this is not sustainable. We cannot really live in isolation or in near isolation.
Yeah.
And we started looking to come to Australia.
Okay. Why did you pick Australia of all the other places in the world at that time?
For the same reason I left Germany for. We had many friends who left Egypt and came to Australia. We lacked friends in Germany, but we had already people who are waiting for us here in Australia, in Sydney specifically. And what they were saying about Australia, that it's easy to blend in. It's easy to integrate because mainly all of us speak a level of English. And this will help us find a job here. But I was lucky. I actually found a job before coming to Australia, and that's why I moved.
Oh, fantastic. So remotely, before your first day, what was the job that you found in Australia?
I found a job as a digital producer in SBS.
Oh, fantastic.
Within the Arabic team.
How about that?
Yeah.
Look at that. So SBS has been crucial in your decision to come to Australia.
Very true. I applied for a job. They interviewed me at 3 a.m. in the morning because of the time difference.
They didn't accommodate for the time difference?
Oh, they tried. I think that was the end of the work day here in Sydney. But I remember this day because they asked me, if you have to write the news today for the bulletin, what would be the top item in the news? And I read just before coming to the interview that a guy called Barnaby Joyce, who was at that time the deputy prime minister, resigned because he had an affair with a woman.
Right.
And I said, I'm gonna include the resignation of Barnaby Joyce, the deputy prime minister, because of his affair. And they were impressed. I think this is the answer that got me the job.
So Barnaby Joyce
played a major role in me coming to Australia. Thank you, Barnaby Joyce.
That's wonderful. So, yeah, it was because you were, I guess, across the local news that it helped you come here. What was the first day in Australia like? Take me through landing in Australia and what it was like.
I landed in Sydney Airport and I was coming from Germany, so forgive me here. I thought it's a little bit chaotic when I landed in Sydney Airport.
The precision of like...
Yes, Frankfurt Airport compared to Sydney Airport. Sydney Airport at that time was a little bit not as organized as
Frankfurt. And still, I think. But it's complete chaos if you get your bag.
Yeah. So that was one of the impressions. And then a friend offered to host me in his house for a few weeks until I find an accommodation. And that was outside the city. It was in near Kellyville. And they had a mall there. I remember the mall because it was one of these new ones where it's flat. It's only one floor. It looks like a village. There is no ceiling and there is this very nice garden in the middle where all cafes look into that garden. And I went there and I sat, and I was lucky. It was in April, so it wasn't really warm. And I had my first coffee there, which was great. The reputation is correct. And I thought, that's a place I can like stay in for long, for some time. I was just coming out of the winter in Germany, which can be harsh.
Yeah, how old were you then? When you came over?
I was 35.
All right, excellent. And it was you and your partner, you came over together?
I came first because I had the job and I had a very little time to show up for the job. They said, okay, the job is yours if you come in 1 month, or I think it was 3 weeks.
Right.
And I said, oh my God, how can I like pack my stuff or sell my stuff in Germany in 3 weeks?
Yeah.
So my partner stayed behind and she took care of that. And I came, and a couple of months later, she joined me.
Ah, there you go. So you had a bit of time to you know, lay down the foundation in Australia.
Yeah.
All right.
I think many migrants do that, especially those who have families. They try to come first, secure a job, rent a place, and try to furnish a little bit of, and before inviting the partner and the kids.
Absolutely, yeah. It was definitely something my father was considering as well. Of going, you know, ahead first. But then we decided, let's all go together.
And the whole family came at once?
Whole family came at once in a tiny one bedroom in West End in Brisbane. We were packed in, typical.
That's brave.
Oh, yeah. I'm always blown away by his, you know, courage in making that move.
Absolutely. I can tell you that the days or the weeks before you leave your home country and go somewhere else, thinking that you're going to settle there for a few years, it's really terrifying. And your mind play all the games against you. Like, what's wrong with this place? Why are you leaving? Like, everyone can make a living here. Why are you upset from the traffic, for example, or from the security? Or your mind is a powerful tool and it wants to stay and keep the status quo. So this person who comes here with a family is a brave man.
Yeah, you're absolutely. When you're saying, you know, your brain is going, oh, you're just thinking the grass is greener. You're worried about certain things here, but they might be issues that follow you.
Exactly.
As you move.
You did that from Brisbane to Sydney, right?
Yes.
Was it scary too?
Oh, it was terrifying for me. That's why when I sit across someone, you know, every week like yourself, that tells me the story of moving their life from country to country, I'm always blown away.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. It worked out. I'm glad it did.
Tell me more about your first weeks in Australia. You said a friend of yours gave you a place to stay, and yeah, that would have been a huge boon in setting up your life, right?
Absolutely. I think I was lucky because I had the security of having a job. I'm going to have a job. I know that there is a paycheck coming at one point. I have a few friends who were with me in the university. So old friends too. That's why they offered to host me, which something I'm very grateful that they did. But of course, coming to a new country, visiting a new city, there is a little bit of fear and a little bit of excitement. It's a fresh start, so it comes with all the romantic feelings that come with a fresh start. I'm going to be better in this country. I'm going to make it here. I'm going to have a nice house. I'm going to have good friends, etc., etc. But there is also the fear. What will happen to me if I don't meet their expectations at work? What will happen to me if I do something wrong? I'm not used to the system here. Maybe I'll do something wrong while not knowing that I did something wrong, and I'll get into trouble. So at the beginning, there are these mixed feelings. But after some time, with the help of others around you, not only friends, but even the common man in the street asking him question and for directions or for anything, you settle in a little bit and you realize from experience that this is a city just like any other city. You have to know your transportation, you have to know where the grocery store is, and you have to find job or go to your work.
Yeah.
Anything other than that, you'll find out later. So take it easy and be patient.
Excellent. You mentioned like the everyday, the common man in the street. How were the people that you met just when you were out and about in Australia compared to back home in Egypt and compared to in Germany?
People in Egypt are very friendly and open, and they want to help you and go the extra mile. I found similarity of that in New York. People are very warm, and they want to ask you genuinely about your day, and they want to say good morning and good afternoon, etc. People in Germany was more reserved.
Yeah.
But when they decide to help you, they will move heaven and earth to help you. Did like unprecedented dedication that I saw in the German. They're reserved, so you wouldn't, and they're busy too. Because the culture in Germany is the culture of achievers.
Right.
We have to go to work and we have to be punctual and we have to be punctual in everything and correct in everything.
Yeah. So not superficial is what you're saying. When they decide that they're going to be helpful to you, they will really commit.
Yes. Excellent. And I found that really amazing. And I had the help of many people in Germany, in the States too, and here in Australia. When I came here to Australia, what was different is the big number of people coming from everywhere that I met in one city. I wasn't used to that. New York is not like that. And of course, Germany is less diverse than New York and less diverse than Sydney. Yeah. But in Sydney, you find people from all walks of life. And this makes you feel less strange. You're not a stranger and you feel that, okay, I don't stand out. I can settle in and blend in. And then you get exposed to many cultures. There are people from the Middle East and people from India and people from Pakistan and Africans, and everyone has his own culture and brings it to Australia. So at the beginning, this was a little bit unsettling for me.
Right.
Because I didn't know, like, should I say hi and good morning and good afternoon to everyone, just like I used to say in my country and in other places, or maybe I'm offending someone by making an eye contact and maybe I shouldn't like interrupt their day. And then I realized that people are people everywhere, whether they come from India, the Middle East, or South America, they're the same people. They want to be respected. They don't mind sharing part of their day with everyone. And they totally can give you directions if you're lost. So I, at the beginning, it was a shocking experience. And I'll tell you the first day I arrived here in Australia.
Yeah.
Before I come for work, I came here for a few days just to do the landing. Mm. And many migrants will understand the landing. It's a requirement in our visas. You have to come in a specific number of months to touch in Australia for a few days or even for a few hours and go back. Otherwise, your visa will be invalid. Mm. So I came to do the landing, and I came in, I think it was 25th or 26th of January. And I went to Central Quay, straightforward. And there was people from all over the world in Central Quay. It was, I think it was Australia Day.
Yeah.
And it was a day off. And Central Quay was very busy. And I saw the whole United Nations in 4 or 5 square kilometers. And I'll tell you, after you get to talk to people and get to know them, you feel very... you feel very safe and secure, and you feel that you are not a stranger. And this is something that is very rare, and people will not understand it until they go countries where you really stand out if you don't look like 95% of the people around you.
Yeah, so you felt on that landing, you felt reassured by the variety of people that you were seeing because of the melting pot. It's not just that I'm different. Everyone here is different in their own way. So we're all kind of different together.
And everyone speaks with an accent. It's not only me. And this is very reassuring. Egyptians have something in their country where you have to speak in an American accent to be cool.
Right.
If you're not speaking with an American accent, you're not cool enough. And when I came here, I realized that I'm cool. Everyone else is. I don't have to be mindful of my accent. As long as I'm clear and people can understand me, I'm good to go.
Absolutely. Excellent. Very good. What about the difference in work culture? It's something that my dad noticed when he came over. And so the way in which, I guess, people interact at work, that was that significantly different when you came to Australia?
Yeah, it's a little bit different. So my first, in Egypt, work culture is we're loud. We're loud people.
Yeah.
We're just saying. We're
Absolutely.
Not yelling. We're just Arabs. And we're loud people, and we like to use our hands, etc. And I remember in when I worked in a magazine, we had like a doll on the shape of a monkey. And it has a voice or an audio sensor. And when we go above a certain level, it screams to ask us to go down, to speak in a...
lower voice.
To speak in a lower voice.
Yeah.
When I moved to work in New York, inside the United Nations, everyone is busy. Everyone is keeping to themselves. Deadlines are very tight. And the only time you have for socialization is between 11:30 and 12:30 when everyone hit the cafeteria, which is huge. When I went to Germany, this was actually more strict than in New York. We had, when I worked in one of the newspapers, someone called workload controller, who makes sure that you are busy every hour of the 7.5 hours you have to work. And busy means like you're writing, you're editing, everything.
Yeah.
So the interaction was much less, and people were really stressed at work.
Yeah, but, short leash.
Yeah, but I saw them achieving more.
Right.
And the quality of work was great.
Mm.
When I came here to Australia, I was lucky to work in SBS. So And I started in the radio department. And the radio department in SBS were not one team, were 63 teams in 63 languages. So I was in the Arabic team, and next to us was the Spanish team. The Spanish team is loud. We're louder. Spanish team and the Arabic team sits next to the Mandarin and Cantonese Chinese teams. And they're very quiet and they like to focus. Right. So they were always complaining, guys, you're too loud. Can you keep it down? And this will work for a few hours and then we go again. I think they lost hope. They gave up.
Very quickly.
Yeah.
Exactly. It reminds me when my partner comes over to spend time with my parents and family at home. And we're speaking in an Indian language.
She's shocked.
She's so surprised because she's going, what's happening? What's the fight? What's the argument about? It's like, no, we're picking the menu for dinner.
See? It's very friendly.
It's friendly, but it's loud. And it's aggressive hospitality, you know? And so that shift in volume and everything was definitely something I had to deal with as well.
Yeah. Currently, I work in SBS newsroom.
Yeah.
And it's a machine. We're producing news, very interesting and special news that is targeted for people who come from different cultures, from different languages, and focusing more on how they can make it here in Australia. So there is this ethical high bar that we have to meet those migrants and intellectual expectations of us. But still, I'm from the Arabic team, the Arabic TV team, and we still were loud. And unfortunately for our colleagues who sit next to us, it's the Chinese TV team. So we're still loud and they still suffer from it. Sorry, guys. I'm saying sorry, but we're trying to keep it down.
Officially. There you go. He's.
I apologize.
I think I'd read part of the reason for that loudness. In India, in Egypt, the populations are so high. When you're in the streets, you have to be right next to the person and speaking loudly for them to hear you in the traffic.
Yes.
Whereas
absolutely.
Here, you can be 15 feet away from someone, have a little whisper, and they'll hear you.
Yeah, no one is honking the horn of the car or calling for their merchandise to sell it. But that's the way in Egypt streets and maybe in India too. So we have to make ourselves heard.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Very good. So you said it was a couple of months after which you brought your partner over. At what point did it feel like you had started to settle in, and when did you make that decision of how she would come over?
This is something that I think people underestimate. They think, we're going to move to a new country and we're going to settle in 6 months. I have tried that in multiple countries.
Yeah.
Australia is the third. And I always hear from different relocation officers that I worked with, that people usually settle in 5 years. And if you do this in less time, then you're an achiever. And by settling, meaning you started to go parallel to those who were born here in their way. Mm. You started to plan for buying a house and how you're going to do with your kids at school and universities and planning for the future. Because the first time, the first year or two, it's survival.
Yeah.
You're trying to survive. You're trying to make sense of the financial system so you don't get penalized, for example. You're trying to figure out how to file a tax return at the end of the year. And definitely along the way, I did mistakes and others will do mistakes too. So you don't feel that you get a hold on everything around you. But with time, and by time I mean like a couple of years, 3 years,
yeah.
I understand how things work here to an extent, and I want to be an Australian. And just recently, and recently means 4 days ago, few days ago,
right?
I passed my citizenship test.
Oh, how about that? I have to. I know the sound engineer will go, what are you doing clapping on mic? But I gotta congratulate you on
Thank
that.
You.
Well
Thank
done.
You.
Well
done. It's a milestone, especially for me, because I moved a lot.
Yeah.
And being able to do that, and maybe in the future call myself, I'm an Egyptian Australian. I'm not only Egyptian, I'm not only Australian. I'm both, is something that that took me some time to achieve. So for people who come here and want to settle in, it's going to take a couple of years, but it's very worth it. And you should do it. And you should not give up early when you face the few obstacles that it's normally to face in any country, whether it's Australia, Canada, the States, Germany. You should not give up. If you made the decision based on thinking and planning, continue. Soldier on. It's going to be better with time.
That's wonderful, because I think you're absolutely right. It takes more time than you think. I think you think you've settled in before you've actually settled in.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And even having this mentality is useful, that you're trying to settle in. Because I see some people, and they have all the right to have that or to say that, oh, we're going to stay here for a few years and then go back. That's absolutely fine. The issue with that, or the challenge that you will face, is you will not try to build foundation here. And maybe you will miss some opportunities. But that's completely fine if this is your decision. I came here and I went to Germany and before that to the States, aiming to settle in every country.
Right.
But I think I managed to do more here and to stay longer. And that's why I decided to be an Egyptian Australian.
Wonderful. What I also wanted to ask you was, after you started working in SBS, representing Egypt, as an Egyptian, when you initially, you know, started in SBS, how did it feel to represent Egypt on the Australian stage? Did you feel that you were representing Egypt, or was that something you would consider?
I felt I'm representing more the Arabic people, the Arabic-speaking people here. Because everywhere I went, especially at the beginning when I went to New York, there was the stereotype about Arabs who is a negative stereotype, and still there. And when I went to Germany, this was actually accumulated because Germany had an influx of refugees from the Middle East.
Right.
During 2012, 13, and after that. So I was always aware that I'm an Arab, and I'm an Arabic-speaking man, and I'm representing these people. I didn't want to do that. I prefer to be myself.
Yeah.
I don't want to be associated only by my citizenship or by the language I speak or by the religion I believe in. I think I'm a human and these things are part of me, but
absolutely,
it's not the whole human experience. But I'm aware that people will think when I speak a little bit loudly that I'm aggressive because I'm an Arab. So I have to be mindful of that too. And when I see people having stereotypes, I would tackle it head on and explain that I come from these countries and I speak that language. And I don't think that what you are saying makes sense. I didn't represent Egypt. I'm an Arabic speaking man. I am a Muslim as well. And I'm very mindful of the stigma that comes with those two words, Arabs and Muslims.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think what you said there resonated personally with me as well, because if they see someone who they see as a local, say, for example, being loud, they'll just attribute it to, oh, that one person is loud. But then if they see you being loud, they'll say Arabs are loud.
And, yeah, your and people.
Yeah, exactly. So that kind of categorizing that can happen based on one person's actions that can resonate through the rest of the community can be difficult to deal with. And so that would have been amplified several fold when you're in the media, right? When you're in a center of focus.
Yes. And you would immediately feel that people's reaction is different when they... something happens here in Australia that I didn't see in other places. People are very keen to know where you are from.
Yeah.
I never heard these questions in Germany or in the States or in many countries that I lived in. But there is this need to know where are you from. Maybe it's to categorize you. Maybe is to try to relate to you or to understand you. I'll leave this to, for people to decide on. But there is, where are you from? I'm from Egypt. What language do you speak in Egypt? Arabic. Oh, okay. I get that a lot.
Wow.
And you just, you have to brush it off and just walk on. If someone has an opinion about me without knowing me or talking to me or spending time with me just because I belong to a country or a culture, I think that's their problem. And they will suffer from that. I will not suffer from that.
Absolutely. Now, that's wonderful. And my opinion of you is that you're a wonderful guest and a wonderful person to speak to. And thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. You're very kind. No, I really enjoyed the conversation. I had fun. And I think it reminded me of many things that happened in the past, positive things. So thank you.
Awesome. Thanks for joining me for another episode. Next week, I'll be joined by Helen Ashley, who moved from PNG with her mother as a young child and was initially overwhelmed by the culture shock, leaving behind the family and life she had known. You can find more info at sbs.com.au/myfirstyear. My First Year on Aussie Soil is an SBS original podcast. It's created and produced by me, Suraj Kolarkar, and Danny Giles.